let's have a race between functions. In the red corner, we have x squared, and in the blue corner, we have e to the x. Which function is greater as x increases? Let's compare the two contestants on a graph. In this race, it's no contest. E to the x is greater than x squared at every point in time. What about something like x to the fifth? In this case, x to the fifth starts out greater, but e to the x passes it in about 13 time units. Even if we were to crank it all the way to x to the 20th, it would take a while, but e to the x will eventually pass it. It turns out that no matter what n you choose for x to the n, e to the x will eventually exceed it. We can use a spreadsheet to check which function is greater, but how do we know that the curves will never cross back over? One way is to use L'Hopital's rule. This theorem allows us to evaluate f of x over g of x as x grows without bounds. If you want an explanation of why it's true, I recommend the 3 Blue, 1 Brown video from his excellent Essence of Calculus series. Here, we'll just use the result. Let's start off with both f and g being polynomials. Say f of x is x to the 4th and g of x is x to the 5th. This is indeterminate, so we can apply the rule and take the derivatives of both functions, knowing that their ratio is still the same as the original indeterminate ratio. In this case, the ratio is still indeterminate, so we keep differentiating the top and the bottom until one of the functions is ground down to a constant. Then we have to stop, as we no longer have an indeterminate form. In this case, the numerator has been ground down to a constant while the denominator still has an x in it, and will therefore still go to infinity as x does. Our form is now a finite number divided by infinity, which is always zero. This means that it's also the ratio of the original form. The numerator, even though it's infinite, is as much smaller infinity than the denominator, such that it's literally nothing in comparison. If the upper polynomial were to have a greater order and remain infinite, then the final answer would be infinity divided by a finite number, which remains infinity. If the term infinity bothers you, just replace the offending word by increases without bounds as x increases without bounds. That's what I mean by infinity in this context, and it is rigorous. Note that the same thing happens if we have polynomials with multiple terms. The lower order terms get ground down to a constant, then to zero, before the higher order terms come to play. The highest order term on either side is the only one that matters, and whichever side has the highest order term wins. Even if the polynomials have coefficients, the coefficients don't matter. The coefficients of the lower term get ground off with their terms, and the coefficient of the highest term gets lumped in with the final finite number. Now that we've played around with L'Hopital's machine for a bit, let's use it for our original problem. We'll use f of x for the polynomial and g of x for the exponential. As we saw before, the derivative of a polynomial eventually gets ground down to a constant, at which point you have to stop L'Hopital's rule, because you don't have the indeterminate form anymore. However, the exponential function is indestructible. Its derivative is always equal to itself. Once the polynomial is ground down, the exponential will still go to infinity, and then you'll have a finite number divided by infinity. And like we've seen before, any finite number divided by infinity is zero. That means that in the long run, any polynomial is insignificant next to the exponential. The exponential beats all. What does this tell us about how the ratio of the two functions look? First, the exponential has a head start at x equals 0 because it's already at 1, while the polynomial starts back at 0. At this point, the ratio is 0. Once the race starts, the polynomial leaves 0 and becomes positive. At this point, the ratio is between two positive numbers, so it has to increase. It has nowhere else to go. We know that the exponential will eventually win, so that the ratio will reach a maximum and start decreasing. It never goes negative, but does drop asymptotically towards zero. So what is this little gem used for? The one near and dear to my heart is in aerospace engineering, and it's called maximum dynamic pressure. Anything moving through air, including a rocket, has to move the air out of the way. That air itself exerts a force back on the rocket, as the equal and opposite reaction that we've learned from Newton's third law. To begin with, the pressure on the rocket increases as its speed increases. However, once the rocket passes through maximum dynamic pressure, or max Q, the pressure on the rocket decreases, even though the speed and altitude are still increasing. The rocket has punched through the thick part of the atmosphere and things just get easier from there on. Once the rocket has passed max Q, it's cleared one of the highest hurdles on its way to orbit. But why then is there a max Q? Dynamic pressure itself is calculated from two terms, one of which is proportional to the square of the speed, and one of which is proportional to the atmospheric density. This density itself is an exponentially decaying function of altitude. As a first approximation, let's say that both the speed and altitude are proportional to time. In this case, the speed term is a polynomial, and multiplying by an exponential decay is the same as dividing by an exponential. Our dynamic pressure is then in the f of x over g of x form that we've seen before. As our rocket launches, the polynomial term starts out winning, and dynamic pressure increases. But eventually, as we've seen, the exponential term catches up, passes the polynomial term, and stays increasingly ahead from there on. We've now passed max Q, and dynamic pressure decreases from then on. In the limit, the polynomial term is so much smaller than the exponential term that the dynamic pressure goes to zero, and we reach the near vacuum of space. I'd like to say a big thank you to 3Blue1Brown and the Summer of Math Explanation Program for the inspiration to finally do something and get it posted. Thanks also to Think Twice for inspiration about mathematics videos that don't have to be a full lesson, just one shiny gem. This project was made possible by open source software and the communities that back up each of the many projects in use. If you're a member or supporter of one of these communities, thank you. I couldn't have done it without you all. This has been Quan 3217, saying if at first you don't succeed, fly again.